For the first time in 27 years, Albany held a sexual harassment in the workplace public hearing. Dozens of witnesses came forward to share their experience and to discuss ways that laws within the state can be strengthened to keep things like this from happening again. And leading this public hearing, Senator Alessandra Biaggi. Senator, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you so much for having me, Morgan. I'm so happy to be here today.
Thank you so much. Senator, you gave a passionate speech at the beginning of the hearing. Let's take a listen.
I want to make crystal clear to the many women who experience sexual harassment, abuse, or violence on a daily basis, you are not alone. To the men who experience abuse, you are not alone. To the LGBTQ community and those who are gender non-binary, you are not alone. We are here to gather knowledge in order to design laws that leave no one unconsidered, that leave no one neglected, ignored, or silenced. We are listening and we will act.
Senator, why was this something you wanted to take the lead on?
Well, I think, you know, during my entire campaign, one of the things that came to the forefront of almost every conversation was ethics. And here in Albany, the ethics committee didn't meet regularly, and there's a real plague of bad behavior and an undertone of sexual harassment here in Albany, but also across the entire state. And so as a woman, as a sexual abuse survivor, this was one of the most important issues that I was fortunate to be able to take on right away because of our leadership who prioritized it, honestly.
Was it hard hearing this testimony?
It was incredibly hard. It was incredibly hard. And I think that, you know, at the moment in time when the survivors spoke from the sexual harassment working group, it was probably, without having the purview of the entire history, right, backwards of all the things that have ever happened here in the legislature, I would argue that it's probably one of the most powerful moments that this legislature has ever seen, that this body has ever seen. You could almost hear a pin drop in that hearing room, and every single legislator from the Assembly to the Senate were, their attention was fully on the testimony being heard.
So building upon that, was there anything in the testimony that you heard that you kind of want to apply to future legislation?
I mean, my gosh, there was, so there's a whole bunch of different issues, but I think one of the biggest themes that we heard, no matter who was really testifying, was the fact that if you are a victim of sexual harassment in the workplace, it is very confusing as to the process of where to go or who to report to or who to talk to or how long will it take for them to investigate or is this the right entity? You know, the Senate and the Assembly have two separate policies. I really believe we should have one. There should be one place where people go, one policy, one set of rules. But we're putting together a report, actually, between the Senate and the Assembly on all of the findings to be able to build off of that and then hopefully have a legislative package that we put forward that we have with the Assembly and the Senate. And I think that that's one of the best ways that we can move forward. But I have to say, because I think this is really important for you to know and for everyone listening to know, I think that that's only the beginning. This is just the beginning steps. One of the hardest things as the chairwoman of the Ethics Committee is to think about how do we create policies and laws that can withstand the test of time and that create a fair structure so that no matter what legislative body is in place, right, because we're not going to be here forever, so when the next body comes in, do those laws withstand that body and the changing values? Are they flexible enough to change with the time? Are they able to really address what's going on in a reasonable and fair way? We don't have to wait 27 more years, right, to address these issues. That is what I'm focusing on every single day, and it's not easy.
So do you hope this kind of leads to a culture change within the Capitol and other workplaces throughout the state?
I really do. I really do. I hope it leads to a culture change. I hope it leads to a change of tide in the behaviors and the ways that people think. And I really hope more than anything that it just creates harassment-free workplaces. No more hiding things under the rug. No more sweeping things, you know, out the door or just, you know, keeping it quiet for political purposes. That time is over. This is a very new day in Albany.
Now, this hearing lasted pretty much all day. So what really
11
stood
hours.
Out? Yeah.
Can you
crazy.
Believe it?
Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
Which, yeah. So what really stood out to you, I guess, when throughout the entire day?
I mean, so I was grateful that we had the commissioners from different agencies come. We had the commissioner of labor come. We also had the executive director from JCOPE, the Joint Commission on Public Ethics. And of course, the sexual harassment working group, definitely their testimony stood out. I think the one of the moments that stood out the most was hearing the testimony from Jacob and hearing a little bit about their process. As many people know, Jacob is a fortress. That was one of the, actually the adjectives that I used when I started my questioning.
I want to kind of take a high level for a moment because I think that this is important to understanding what I often like to call the fortress that is Jacob, because it's hard to understand what is happening inside of your walls.
If we can't see inside or don't really know what's going on, we don't know what law to actually change. So hearing about the questioning process and then learning that some of the victims, alleged victims coming forward, were being asked questions about their sexual history, I mean, that just totally blew my mind. It blew my colleagues' minds. And it just made us stop for a moment, literally, and say, Is this really a trauma-informed inquiry process? I think also another thing that we learned was that perhaps Jacob is not the correct entity to be handling these cases. So in 7 years, the number I believe was about 44 cases, and of those 44 cases, 3 were settled. How can that possibly be? Come on. I mean, this is totally crazy. So I think that they probably would also agree, and I think that anybody who is reasonable would say that number is way too low, and perhaps they don't have the right resources, and ultimately, perhaps they're not the right entity.
Do you hope there is a shakeup kind of within Jacob after this hearing?
I really do. I was actually disappointed to hear that in their monthly meeting, the issue of sexual harassment was not brought up, as far as we know. So that was disappointing, and I was kind of, it was actually more curious as to why that was not the case. I think that a real independent entity to oversee ethics in the state is what the state of New York and all 20 million New Yorkers deserve, to be honest, and that probably means that Jacob should not actually be an entity at all. It should be eliminated, in my opinion, and that's why I'm a co-sponsor of Senator Krueger's constitutional amendment to eliminate Jacob, to eliminate the LEC, to have a truly independent body. And this goes back to what we were talking about earlier. I'm thinking about how do we create laws that withstand the test of time, but how do we create an entity that's truly independent? If you think about that, that's one of the hardest things to accomplish. So it's not an easy task, but it's the time to do it.
Exactly. Now, you are a freshman senator, but you're already taking the lead on so many policy discussions. So how has it been adjusting to life in Albany?
Oh, my goodness. It has been a whirlwind in every sense of the word, but also one of the most gratifying and amazing experiences. And amazing not in, like, the literal sense of the word. Truly, like, I am amazed by what is going on here. It is really a responsibility of a lifetime to be able to sit in a seat and know that whatever decision I make, if I vote yes or if I vote no, will affect the 300 plus thousand people in my district. I feel incredibly responsible to them. So whatever issue comes forward, I'm thinking, how does it affect the people in Pelham or Riverdale or Hunts Point or City Island or wherever? And it's not easy, as you can imagine. I mean, there's all different types of populations and people and have different interests, and it's totally wild and amazing at the same time. It's not an easy task, but it is an absolutely worthwhile, once-in-a-lifetime experience.
Well, Senator, thank you so much for coming on. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me, really.